Do you like pineapple pizza?
This is a very contentious issue, and I refuse to answer.
That's very wise. You want to give a presentation, you don't want to start a riot. Yeah. Okay. So we would ask definitely that we keep the political questions to a minimum. So no more of that. I should have known better than to poll the audience. Still waiting on the thumbs up. They're getting there. They've ambled on over. It's okay. We can wait just a couple more minutes, maybe one more minute. No, you guys want this now. You guys want this immediately. You can't wait. Yeah. Okay. Let's. I want you guys to just throw up your fist. Okay. No, you don't have to throw up your fist because now I got the signal. We're A-okay. I'm gonna hand this off to Dragos, and he is going to tell us all about Bitcoin in the post-quantum era. Spooky.
Hi. Yes. So as I said, my name is Dragos, and basically what I'm working on is sort of this new technology appears, which is quantum computers, and how can Bitcoin like exist in this world, or like is Bitcoin and all other financial systems and all cryptography doomed? No. So we are basically finding a solution for something that doesn't really, it's not a problem yet. And how often does that happen? It's very good. Sort of the plan that I want to, my plan for today is basically to talk a lot about the quantum world. And I'm not going to go into very, very spooky things like entanglement, but I just want to make everyone understand the idea of superposition. And then I'm going to basically build up to Shor's algorithm, which is the thing we care about in Bitcoin, because this is what breaks the public key cryptography that Bitcoin has. Then I'll show the problem that appears in Bitcoin and one simple solution that we can have to solve this problem. In order to build quantum computers, we will need this concept of a qubit, which is the counterpart of the classical bit. And we can choose as a qubit any quantum system with a binary state. So for example, we can take an electron, which is like in a ground state of energy or in an excited state of energy. We can take a polarized photon or the spin of an electron. And it doesn't really matter if you don't know what these things are, but the point is it has to be a binary system, which when measured will produce one of the two results, one of the two states. And the catch is that, if you probably heard of this superposition, it allows us, when we are not measuring this particle or this this quantum state, the state can exist in a superposition of both states, both basis states. And in order to explain this concept, I will first explain what, like for example, I have here a hydrogen atom with an electron that's, one second, circling around the nucleus. And if I excite this electron with a laser pulse, for example, let's say 100 milliseconds, let's say it goes into the excited energy state. So that's all good. There is no superposition until now. But now what happens if I only shine the laser on this electron for 40 milliseconds? Well, it turns out that what happens is that 40% of the time, the system will evolve into the excited state, and 60% of the time, it will stay on the ground state. And this is pretty weird, and I really want to try to kind of explain why this is happening, because it's not just magic. It's actually very, very, very much possible. What happens is that electrons aren't really particles, as you probably heard of the thing called wave-particle duality. What this means is that basically classical physics says everything is a particle. Then quantum mechanics comes along and says, no, everything is a wave. And then afterwards, quantum field theory comes along and says, no, you got it all wrong. Everything is a field. And then our string theory is like everything is a string. So anyway, we are just going to stay at quantum mechanics, which says everything is a wave. So now if we have a wave like this, if we basically arrange this wave such that it lives in the same space as another wave, they will basically sort of add together and will create this more strong wave. And you see this in like waves on the sea. It's nothing new. Again, if the waves are like sort of shifted from each other, the interference is going to be called destructive. And what will happen is that this sort of pattern will appear. So it means that the water on the sea, it will be sort of stable. And you see this at the crests of the waves. Like you see that they are sort of stable. Like somewhere are waves, somewhere are not. And because electrons are actually waves, like this, what basically happens is that and we'll need my hands here, if the electron would travel just through space, everything would be fine, it's a wave. But because it's going very close, in a close orbit around the nucleus, this wave interferes with itself, basically, creating something like here. So you can see that if it wraps around exactly the number of times, like in an integer number of times of the circumference, it will basically be stable. But if it offsets even just a bit, if like the wrapping around of the wave happens such that a crest doesn't match perfectly with the crest, but it's like a bit offset, like for example here, like we have one wave and then another one, but a bit offset, what will happen is that because this happens many, many times, even a small offset will lead to complete destructive interference. So what this means is that, for example, if we look at this picture, which you've maybe seen on the internet before, which basically shows how we take pictures of atoms. What we do is we just shine some radiation and we see the way it's deflected by the electrons, and then we can say an electron was here. And then we do this like thousands of times, millions of times, and we build some kind of a picture where we see where electrons are usually exist. And basically this first wave would wrap around in a sort of constructive interference pattern around this nucleus, and many, many electrons will be found here because the energy is stable there, because the wave exists. And then here, this is like a higher energy level. You can tell this by the fact that this wave has a shorter wavelength. And this is wrapping around at a farther distance from the nucleus because it has more energy. And it exists there. And now the question would be, why can I not be in the middle? Why can I not be in between the levels? And the reason is because, as I was showing here, if the wavelength is not a perfect multiple, if the circumference of the orbit that you're trying to do is not a perfect multiple of the wavelength, then you will get a bit of an offset, which will lead to this, which will lead to basically dark spots, so places where energy cannot exist. And what this means is, it has like, this is basically the concept of superposition. So the idea is that it's not like when we superimpose these two waves, the resulting wave doesn't exist. It exists, and I'm not drawing it here just because it doesn't exist in the real sense. It exists as a complex probability wave, which is more complicated to show. But the point is that this wave exists, it's just that we cannot measure it. Whenever we would measure it, we would either get one of these two stable things, because if we would try to measure a superposition of these waves, we would get some kind of this effect where the result will just cancel out with itself because it interferes with itself. So it's there, but because it's interfering with itself, it disappears, and we cannot measure it. And what we would measure is just one of the stable orbits. So this is kind of what superposition is. Now, if some of you went to this talk in Borg about quantum computers, somebody there already explained Grover's algorithm. So, but I'll go over it a bit faster. The idea is that this algorithm, what we want to do is to search for some piece of data, let's say x plus 1 equals 5, in some unstructured data. Well, this is of course structured, but you can imagine where the order doesn't matter. It's like random data. And you'll see how this makes sense. We can now arrange a quantum state where basically each possible value that we measure, each basis state, is it has equal probability of being measured. And so again, if we measure right now the quantum state, we get randomly one of these values. What we do next is we apply this sort of function, which basically verifies if x plus 1 equals 5, which is our wanted value, and it will change the amplitude of the wave. So what this means is that one of those waves that would add together to create the superposition, we are basically changing its phase such that the amplitude of the complex probability of this wave goes to minus 1. I don't want to trick you. The probability, if we now measure the state, the probability of this happening is equal to probability of this happening or of this happening, because in order to measure a complex, to get from a complex probability to a real probability, you have to square the number. So minus something squared is still the same thing squared positively, so it's still the same probability. But this, basically, the fact that we shifted this phase allows us to do stuff like this. We then say we will reflect around the average. And I could explain what this means mathematically, but basically what is happening is that if we have a wave like this, and at some point the wave is like down, and now we apply some sort of electromagnetic field or like some microwave radiation or stuff like this, we will basically be able to change the amplitude of this wave up by taking energy from all the other waves. So we sort of make them smaller. And this way we basically made the chances of us measuring this thing much higher, but it's still under half. So we will do it, we again negate it, and we again amplify it. And in time, apparently after exactly square root of n, where n is the number of possible states, we get like the best probability that we could get, like the best that we can do. And I have here some mathematical description of this algorithm. And the reason I have this is because the next algorithm that I will show you, which is Shor's algorithm, is a lot more complicated, so I cannot just show you with just like some states. So I want to familiarize yourselves with like this algorithm base, this idea of notation like this. So what this says is that I'm going to start with an empty register, just zeros inside, nothing interesting for now. And then I'm going to put it in a superposition of possible states. So what this is saying is that for every possible state, like 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, every possible state has a probability of being measured, which is equal for all of them. So we call this superposition. We just add this possible state and their probabilities. That's all good. Now, when we say invert the amplitude of the wanted value, we basically just invert the probability. Again, this is just a complex probability. The real one would have the same value as the real probability of this one, which is alpha squared. So the superposition now changes into this superposition, which basically has all the states that are not our wanted value with equal probability, and this one negated. And then when we say inversion around the mean, what we do is we basically take the average and we say, now the state becomes 2a plus 2a minus what was there before. So in the case of minus alpha, we get 2a plus alpha. And in the case of just alpha here, we get 2a minus alpha. So this is very nice because obviously this is a higher probability even squared than this is a higher than this probability. So it means that we did something good. Like we are now more likely to measure this value which we want to find. So how is this useful in terms of Bitcoin? Well, if you think about what hashing, what proof of work does, is you're basically trying to find the nonce such that the hash of a message, which is like the block header and the nonce, is smaller than some threshold. So it turns out that, in fact, if you know that you are looking for more possible values and you are looking, in fact, for t values, you can do better than just square root of n. You can do square root of n over t. And also, because we want maybe to run this computation in parallel so that we mimic the way classical computers compute hashes. We won't require, you know, like the best probability we can achieve. So we won't do this many steps. We'll just do less, but in parallel or multiple quantum computers at the same time. So this might actually be very profitable for mining. So for breaking hashes, not so much, because this is just like a quadratic speedup. It's just square root of n, which is still very large. And if I just make the key, the security size, the security parameter twice as big, I'm solving this problem. I'm back to the same security I had before. So this is not very impressive. But if I'm talking about mining, then yes, I might have a huge advantage. Still, though, quantum computers are quite far away in the future, and by the time we'll probably get to have them stable enough to do this sort of computations, they will probably also be popular enough, so more people will have them. So mining might just be done with quantum computers by default because they have such a good speed up compared to classical computers. So let's not worry about Grover's algorithm and how it can affect Bitcoin too much, but let's just think about the fact that quantum attackers might be able to do proof of work much faster than other people. And now this is the problem that Bitcoin faces. Shor's algorithm. The idea is here that we are looking for something that has like a certain value which is like in a database which has an underlying structure. So for example, integer factorization is a modular arithmetic. So every a certain period that we choose, the numbers will repeat perfectly. So there is some kind of structure underlying this this group. And this is called a hidden subgroup problem. And it can be reduced to something called period finding, which just means I want to find the period of this function. Can I do it or not? And classical computers cannot do this. They can only do it in exponential time, which is not good. And Shor's algorithm actually can do it in polynomial time, which is very good. And only linear number of qubits compared to the key to the security parameter. So with around 1500 qubits, we can basically break ECDSA in like seconds. So this would be very, very bad for Bitcoin. So I will try to sort of show you how this algorithm goes. We start from a superposition of two registers. Well, they are first empty, and then we arrange them in a superposition. So We put here all the possible values for x, like all the possible inputs that our function could have. And here we just put an empty register, because we want to store on it the value of x, of f of x. So we have now a superposition, which if we measure the state right here, we will just get an input value and an output value. That's it. So that's not very useful for us. What we will do instead is we will just measure this part of the computation. We will just measure this f of x. And of course, because we measure this value, the state collapse is one of the basis states of this register, which is going to be, let's say, value m. But the trick part is, like, where the quantum superposition capabilities appear, is that the x register will not just go to one input value, because there are multiple inputs that could produce this m. And there is nothing that forced the quantum state until now to settle on one of them. So it will actually still be a superposition of all the possible inputs that would have f of x equal to this m. And I represent this by saying, you know, some multiple of the period of the function r plus some offset l. And if I measure this, and I only measure this right now, if I measure this right now, I will get one of the possible input values. So again, that's not very useful. What I will do instead is I will run the this computation again, and I will measure again this f of x. Now, if I measure it again with very, very high probability, I will not get m again. I will get a different m prime with a different set of solutions x, which are still a multiple of the period plus a different offset. So we have now, we are now at a point where we have these two states, which are very close to what we want, because what we really want is to find the period. So now there is this function called the quantum Fourier transfer, transform, and from people who do like maybe sound related stuff or who know frequencies or amplitudes, they know that the Fourier transform basically allows you to decompose frequencies into the basic frequencies that, that are composed of it. Well, in here the frequency is just R and it's offset by some L, so it's not very interesting to find it. But we still want to get rid of this different L and L prime. We just want to be left with this basically. So we apply the quantum Fourier transform and we will get back a state which is a superposition of multiples of the period. And now we just need to measure this state two times. So that's why we do this computation two times. Because we want to guarantee that the multiple here is going to be different. So we will get one time J1R and the second time another multiple of the period. And of course, we can just find the common divisor of these numbers, and that's how we get a period. Of course, if they are multiples of one each other, then we just do the computation multiple times until we get things that would basically deterministically determine a certain period. And yes, this is it with the quantum part. This is it. But what I hope you can appreciate is that in Bitcoin, we use this elliptic curve point exponentiation in a finite field, which is just elliptic curve digital signature algorithm. And in order to solve it, we need to solve the discrete logarithm problem. And this is a problem, basically, it's discrete because it's happening in a finite field, again, with modular arithmetics. And this function, again, shows a certain period. So it means that we can solve this with Shor's algorithm. And as I was saying earlier, we can do it with like around 1,500 qubits, which is actually less than we can break RSA with, just as an aside. And basically, once we can do this, transactions are not safe anymore, and we will see this. So we are right now in this place where it's all safe. I have my secret key, I generate my public key, I can give it to anyone, and everybody is happy. They can never find my secret key. But the problem is that Shor's algorithm will move us into this world where this is just trivially, like, it will be trivially for me to compute your secret key if I just see your public key. So just to measure how big the impact is, in Bitcoin right now, 10.2% of the bitcoins are stored in outputs which are paid to public key, which means that the public key is just visible in the output. So anyone who has a quantum computer, which hopefully nobody does now, will go scan for these public keys, and he will basically compute the secret keys and steal the money. Then another 23.3% of the public key of the bitcoins in existence are stored in scripts that basically reveal the public key when they are spent in the input. So by and large, 33, like a third of bitcoins if you would have a quantum computing, this would be like the pool of money, the prize you win for finding a quantum computer. You can take 33% of Bitcoins. And the other 66% of Bitcoins, the public key is not revealed, but in order to spend the money in those in that public key, you need to show it in the input. So that's also a problem we are trying to solve. Now, how do you sort of solve the problem of ECDSA? Well, it's not very complicated. We will just develop a new signature scheme which is quantum resistant, and there are here some candidates for this, like lattice-based cryptography, multivariate cryptography, and they all rely on the fact that they these groups don't present a certain underlying structure. The disadvantages are that the key sizes are larger, the verification times are larger, but we will have to make do with these things. Now, the problem appears is, let's say, very nice, we deploy these quantum resistant signatures, we now have transactions, we spend our classical, we spend using our classical signature ECDSA, and we create some quantum resistant address, and now our money is saved. But sort of what I'm trying to describe is the scenario where a user wakes up in 100 years, and he still has his money in some output that doesn't show the public key, but he now needs to spend them, and he doesn't know how to do that because the problem is that when you do this, if a quantum computer exists right now, he can just compute your secret key right now. There you go. And make a malicious transaction which basically front runs your transaction. So if he can do this, if he can derive a transaction which is malicious and get it in the memory pool and accept it in the blockchain faster than you can do, he is basically front running you. So this simple scheme with just the classical signature is not secure. We cannot rely on this for the transition to quantum resistance. So what we have to do is to basically create the idea of a quantum resistance surrogate. So once we have deployed quantum resistance signatures, we are now able to also verify them. We will add to the protocol rules some things that go like this. First of all, we require this stuff because this is still broken, like we can still break this, but this part we cannot. Like this is still quantum resistant. So again, we go this, in the transaction, in the input, we will add this quantum resistant signature. But of course, the problem is that we need a way to basically prove that the owner of the public key, the classical one, is the owner of the new quantum resistant public key. And this is basically where the transition protocol has to come in. And what we have to do is to basically give some proof that this owner is common for both of them. So the way we would do that, our proposal is that we will basically just implement a hash commitment scheme where we, in a transaction that is very much ago in the past, very, very buried below many blocks, such that the quantum attacker cannot rewind the blockchain using his Grover algorithm to mine much faster than everyone else can. So this is like very much buried in the blockchain. And you have here a hash of the pair of the public keys that you're trying to link together, these two things. And if an attacker would try now to basically claim that, no, my public key is the public key that should unlock this is actually this one, which is his public key, the attacker's one, he would not be able to complete this proof because he would need to, first of all, in order to publish this transaction, he would need to roll back the blockchain for 6 months in order to insert this thing. So there is no such proof that can be constructed. And as he cannot do this, the protocol basically looks like this. So you would start by having a commit phase where you generate a public key quantum, you generate a quantum resistant public key pair. You make this sort of transactions where you're just publishing the hash. And again, Grover doesn't help with just breaking the hash. It would help with mining because it's a speed up, but it still doesn't solve hashes. So this is safe. You can do this transaction. Then you wait for a long time. And we argue that this parameter has to be basically enforced globally. Because if we don't enforce it globally, if let's say people just say, oh, I will wait for 3 months, I will wait for 2 months, I will wait for 1 month, then the problem appears that the quantum attacker can himself insert the commit transaction just like 20 blocks ago and say, yes, I waited for only 20 blocks. So it has to be something enforced in the scheme, in the protocol itself. Why 6 months and not shorter or not longer? It's a different story and quite an interesting argument. The idea is that attackers could try to basically create multiple forks to confuse the network and to, because they have more mining power, so it would be quite easy for them to do it. But we argue that 6 months of rollback is either impossible or the community would take out of bounds measure and would basically stop this fork. Like a fork that is 6 months old would definitely be stopped. This is my talk. These are two papers that we wrote on this subject. And you can find more information about post-quantum cryptographic schemes or at these links. Yes, are there any questions? Yes, please. There's somebody in the back.
I have actually two questions.
Yes.
First is, this scheme would require a hard fork, right?
No, this scheme would can be done with a soft fork because in here, all I am adding extra stuff is the signature, and this is already in the input. And this we can put in a segregated area, like SegWit was deployed. And yes, and we would still verify the classical signatures. So okay. Old miners would just think this is all normal. And the new miners would also verify the quantum resistance signature and this Merkle proof that this transaction exists.
OK. And the second question is, what would prevent the attacker to publish the commitment transaction?
What? Can you repeat?
What would prevent the attacker to actually outrace the honest user in the commit phase?
So I think what you're asking is, when I make this commit transaction, what prevents the attacker of front running this? Yeah. Well, he can, but he won't be able to put in the value that he wants here, because this is a hash of the pair. So he would need to know my public key in order to make a link to it. And he doesn't, because we assume it's not revealed. And if it is revealed and he has a quantum computer, then you are lost anyway. You cannot save it. Any other questions? Yes.
Can you explain how finding the period helps us find the factorization of numbers or discrete logs?
So there is a mathematical demonstration for this, which I don't think I can reproduce right now. But yes, I can basically, I can explain to you afterwards. That, like, it's quite complicated. Other, yes.
I'm a bit confused at the moment because I think that when it comes to stating the premise of your talk, you basically skip the toughest part of the talk in like two sentences.
The post-quantum cryptography.
Yeah, which was like, how do I get quantum? How do I get Bitcoin post-quantum crypto? Is by just implementing a post-quantum crypto signature.
So.
Which I would have thought would be the focus of this talk.
So I understand what you're thinking, and basically these schemes are actually post-quantum cryptographic schemes that were developed well before the actual schemes we have, like 30 years before the ECDSA and RSA. But they were not used because of various reasons, and really much smarter people than me are doing this and are solving these issues, and they have been solved basically.
Well, this is where I would disagree with. I'm actually partially working in the field, and as far as I know, the NIST challenge is still open.
Yes,
and
of course.
There is no form of any way of having a post-quantum crypto signature scheme available at the moment that has withstood only a limited amount of rigor. So far, we have 9 quantum signature schemes in the running in the NIST challenge, and none of them is anything that any person who takes crypto seriously by an inch would touch and call secured. So what I would basically propose as a rephrasement of your talk statement is that what you're showing is not getting Bitcoin post-quantum crypto secure, but what you're arguing is that given that the existence of a post-quantum signature scheme, you propose a scheme to implement quantum agility in existing Bitcoin schemes, which is a completely different claim from saying that you're making Bitcoin post-quantum secure, because you basically argue that there needs to be a post-quantum secure signature scheme, which we don't have yet.
In some sense, I see what you're saying, but I guess the point of the talk is how do you transition? Like, part of the problem is indeed what you're saying, which is what you're working on apparently, and it's way beyond my level of understanding of how this works, really. So indeed, once you have a post-quantum cryptographic scheme, my point is that that's not enough, because you also need a way to move from the current one in the presence of a quantum computer.
And that would be the second one where I would... I'm happy that you basically took that question from me, so that given we have a post-quantum crypto signature scheme, which is a big if at the moment, will approximately remain to be for the next 3 or 4 years, at least if we look at the speed of the NIST challenge moving ahead, and the talks like Tanya Lange and CJB just gave today, the next question is, have you done a formal reduction proof to show which crypto primitives are used by your transition by implementing the... So have you done a formal reduction proof to show that even if I have a post-quantum crypto signature scheme, you have a formal reduction that Bitcoin is as hard to crack as the primitive?
That Bitcoin is?
Well, have you done a formal reduction proof?
So yes, given the assumptions of hash functions and assumed assumptions of what a post-quantum resistance scheme, signature scheme would give you, then yes, you can find it in the first paper, which is this one.
So because I tried to read it last night and I was...
But I think it's sort of intuitive to see why this is happening. Like, it's just that
you
are not...
It's sort of intuitive to say that finding prime factors is hard and quantum computers do it. Isn't that what quantum computers taught us? That, it's sort of intuitive to see that they can't do this is what quantum computers have fooled
us. I would argue it's
time and time again that they can do the things that we do not expect them to be able to do.
I think like Shor's algorithm was done in the 1970s. So for a long time, we knew that we can do this sort of calculations. Yes. It's just that practically we cannot. But this is like theoretically speaking, we can. And for quantum computers. But in this case as well, if you take some assumptions theoretically, you can see why this would work. Like you don't. But yes,
the point is, I don't see any validation of your assumptions. You assume basically that you don't see an intuitive way to have a quantum computer break your implementation. So what you basically...
I think you're basically asking if there is another way that the quantum computer could break this that I'm not imagining because I'm not... okay, I see. Yes.
Because a formal reduction proof would protect you from that.
I see
if
what
you
you're
would
saying,
do, if you would do a formal reduction proof, you could go ahead, do a formal reduction proof on your Bitcoin setup, show that it is as hard to crack as the quantum primitives it is employing, and... then say that due to the fact that you're relying
on the quantum resistant primitives.
Yeah.
Oh.
No. Well, the crypto primitives, and since you are employing a post-quantum crypto primitive, then your Bitcoin is fine. But given the assumptions that you made, I don't see you doing a formal reduction proof on that.
So I think I'm not exactly sure anything, but yes, like you can find it in the paper. But the point is that.
Well, I didn't. That's why I'm asking.
Okay. I can talk to you about this later. We can talk right now. Yeah. Is there the next talk or other questions?
Now, guys, we just heard them clapping, and we have to clap louder than they clapped because we have better guests than they do. So I want to hear it once more, but with feeling. Now they're all jealous over there. See, this is how we get speakers. This is how we get quality speakers to our cluster. Thank you so much. Thank you. Hope we all learned a thing about quantum computing and Bitcoin and how it's going to fare or how it's not going to fare. I'm going to have to rewatch that talk. I was very eating. So that's what was happening with me.